Let me do this. There's a word that sometimes scares people. It's a church word, but it scares people. As a matter of fact, I've had people over the years tell me that they like this church, and but because it's kind of an open place and we're open-minded, if you will, although I'm not at all. I'm an extremely happy, content, closed-minded Christian. And what I mean by that is that if it's not in this book, you can have it. I don't want it, okay? So I'm pretty closed-minded, but there's a word that scares people away. I've had people say this. When you guys start preaching doctrine over there, you start hitting the doctrine, I'm out. You see, here's the thing with a doctrine. A doctrine is just basically this. It's a belief system. It's widely accepted teaching of Scripture. Like there's a doctrine of creation, there's a doctrine of salvation, there's a doctrine of sin, all those things. It's the fullness of what the Bible teaches on a specific topic. That's what a doctrine is. But see, people don't like that because, let's just be honest, right? We don't like to be told what to do. Nobody likes to be told what to do, right? We just don't. And even if we love God, we still, at our core, we don't like to be told what to do. We want to be independent. We're enlightenment people. We're the center of the universe. Like no one would come right out and blatantly say, I'm God. I'm amazing. I'm awesome. I've got it down pat. Like, we don't openly say those things, but our life displays those things. We love God, we obey God, right? But do we really? Do we honor Him? Do we spend time with Him all the time? Do we obey His word? Do we do what it says to do? Like, or do we just kind of do it on our own? You know? And the Bible tells us to trust in the Lord with all your heart and to lean not on your own understanding. Why would but to seek God's will in all that you do, and He'll direct your paths? Why does God say that? Because we think we're God. We think we know what we're doing. So God tells us, hey, listen, you really don't have it figured out. I love the suspenders, by the way, just saying. I think that's a dying thing. I think that you should, I like that, and you should stick with it until it comes back. I love suspenders. I think, stand up for a second. Come on, man. Just show everyone the suspenders. Those are cool, man, seriously. Those are cool, man. I like the suspenders. I like it. I like it. I got you. So anyway, well, our actions just would show otherwise. We don't like doctrine, but we can't avoid it. It's what the Bible is. So let me give you a specific doctrine that I wanted to touch on first tonight. And it's this doctrine of total depravity. Total depravity. Okay, now, let me tell you what total depravity is, just so you can understand. I have it here on my phone. I'm not just texting anybody. let me read this to you. Total depravity has a couple of different names. It's not just total depravity. It's sometimes called radical corruption or pervasive depravity. And it is a doctrine, a theological doctrine, derived from this concept of original sin, okay? This fall of man, you know, Adam and Eve, they're in the garden, everything's great. God said, do whatever you want except this one thing. Don't eat that fruit right there. Don't eat that off that tree, right? And so they rebel because nobody likes to be told what to do. It's been going on for a long time. And so because of the fall of man, this total depravity means because of this fall, because of this sin, that every person born into this world since then is enslaved to the service of sin as a result of their fallen nature. And apart from the prevenient grace of God, which means God moves upon the sinner before he even accepts Jesus as Lord and Savior, but moves upon you and says, hey, dude, you need some help. You can't get this right on your own. That's what prevenient grace is. He moves upon the sinner. So it says here, let me go back. Every person born into this world is enslaved to the service of sin as a result of their fallen nature, and apart from the prevenient grace of God, is utterly unable to choose to follow God, refrain from evil, or even to accept the gift of salvation as it is offered by God. It is an absolute, complete corruption of the human race that apart from God, since Adam and Eve sinned, that you are absolutely on your own, incomplete, incapable of staying away from evil, doing good, serving God. You don't want to serve God. That's just, it's a universal indictment against all people, okay? Now, I don't want to just throw that out there without supporting it with Scripture, right? That's what we do here. And I want you to, I love this, they got notebooks out. If you have a notebook, please make note of these things. I ask you to turn to Ephesians chapter 2, and please go there. And look right here in the first three verses. I want to read these with you, because I don't want to just throw something out there that's big and just say, hey, you need to just swallow this thing, whether you like it or not, whether it's Bible or not. No, I want you to see it with your own eyes. Is what I'm claiming supported by Scripture. Well, in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1, it says this. Are you there? Are you there? Okay. Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. He's talking to the church in Ephesus. These are followers of Christ. And some theologians think that it's not just Ephesus that he's speaking to, but all the churches in Asia Minor, where Turkey is now, that it was a circular letter. So he's talking to Christians in that whole area, okay? So he's talking to the Christians. He says, once you Christians were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins, you used to live in sin, just like the rest of the world. Do you see the university there? I mean the universal indictment. Just like the rest of the world lived in sin, okay? Obeying the devil, and then he illustrates who and tells us who the devil is, the commander of the powers in the unseen world. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us used to live that way. See the universality there again? Do you see it? Do you see it? Everybody. All of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, just who we are, right? Just because you're a human, it says, we were subject to God's anger just like everyone else. So you see, when I say total depravity, the picture that's painted here is that it's every single person. That's universal, right? Also, it's complete depravity. He uses one word here that describes complete depravity. You were dead. Now, let me ask you this, interaction from the congregation. What can a dead man do? Show me. Nothing, right? So complete depravity. It's all of us can do nothing, and it's everybody. Total depravity of mankind. Now, here's some more biblical support for this doctrine. Romans 5:18, you can jot that down. It just says this, yes, Adam's one sin brings condemnation for everyone. Everyone is universal, right? One sin, every single person. Romans 3 is just packed, filled with this proof. Romans 3, at the beginning it says, no one is righteous, not even one. No one is seeking God, and no one does good. Universal, right? Romans 3:19 says this, this is true. No one's good, and God gives us the law. He gives the Jews the law to do right, and to prove this group of people, they have my law. These are my people, right? But not only that, but the Bible says in Romans 3:19 that he gives us the law, and what does it do other than to identify who we are and show us how to live? It also shows that every single person is guilty before God. See, you know, you've all heard of the Ten Commandments, right? It's nothing new, right? So there's this list. It's only 10 things. And since they were carved in stone, not one person has been able to keep them just right except Jesus. No one. It's universal. It points out that we're all guilty before a perfect and holy God. Now, I told you the first week that the book of Ephesians is not like 1 Corinthians in any way, in that it's not a rebuke of the church. 1 Corinthians is a rebuke of the church. They're misbehaving, right? And Paul's like, dude, seriously? You're getting hammered on communion wine. This guy's sleeping with his stepmom. I mean, come on, get right. Tighten up, right? Tighten up. And so he writes this letter. He's like, you guys need to tighten up, right? But that's not like this. I told you that Ephesians was a book that was encouragement. Remember, it was to faithful followers of Christ? These weren't misbehaviors. These were God's holy people, faithful followers of Christ. They were doing it right. And so Paul writes this letter for encouragement. But what I'm reading to you already, That doesn't sound very encouraging, does it? You're all completely broken, busted, and lost. Like, that doesn't sound encouraging. But there's good news. There's good news. Okay? If you read on in this same chapter, look what it says. We were subject to God's anger just because of our nature, just like everyone else. But God. That's the good news, right? But God. But God. So he makes this long list that you were dead because of your sin, and you were subject to God's anger and wrath and all this stuff. But God. But God, in spite of all these things, even because you did this, you were totally undeserving of this thing. However, here's the good news. But God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much that even though you were dead because of your sins, he gave you life when he raised Christ from the dead. That was a great amen spot. That was a great amen spot. See, that's the good news. See, it was totally dark. You were completely busted, completely corrupted. You could not get better. There was no way to do it. You're a dead man. But even though you were dead, in a sense, he reaches down into the grave and says, "Wake up, child. I give you life." Paul would say it this way in Romans 3:23. This is one of the most very, very famous verses in Scripture. You know, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You've heard this, right? It's a very popular verse that's not going to be in a coffee cup, though. Like, and I'm not going to go to the store and buy that one. Yeah, I'm a sinner. Like, that's not going to be on a t-shirt. It's very famous. But the next verse, if I was deciding on famous verses, I'd say the next one was very, very famous. I think this one is the one that should make t-shirts. It says, just like the one we just read in Ephesians, we're this, but God is so rich in mercy. But in Romans it says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, yet God, just like but, yet God. In other words, even though you were this, even though you're a sinner, even though you fall short of my glorious standard, even though you can't get it right, yet God, with undeserved kindness, declares us righteous in Christ Jesus. Unbelievable. Unbelievable truth. It is universal. All sin. All fall short. All are dead. All are following their sinful inclinations. As a matter of fact, John in 1 John would say, if you say you are without sin, you are fooling yourself. And don't we all do that on occasion? We fool ourselves, thinking that somehow we can make it without the good Lord. Total depravity. Everyone. And complete. Flatline, dude. Flatline completely. But God is rich in mercy. And with undeserved kindness, he reaches into your grave and gives you life. And he does some things, right? Now, if you read on, look at verse 7. Go back to Ephesians chapter 2. You there? So Ephesians 2:7 says, so God can point to us in all future ages as examples of the incredible wealth of his grace and kindness toward us, as shown in all he has done for us who are united with Christ Jesus. So here we are, this dead man, this dead woman, incapable of saving ourselves, unable to avoid evil, cannot follow God, cannot accept Christ, cannot have glory, cannot get better. We're totally corrupted, totally depraved in every single way. Yet God, rich in mercy, undeserved kindness, he gives us life. That's his grace. That's his kindness. Now, what has he done for all of us? What has he done for the dead man? What's he done for the dead woman? Ephesians 1:4, he loved you and chose you. 1:5, he adopted you into his family. 1:7, he purchased your freedom from sin and forgave you of your sins. He purchased your freedom from sin. He gave you the Holy Spirit in Ephesians 1:13, and that power that raised Christ from the dead, it lives in you. And so he purchased your freedom from sin. You don't have to sin anymore. When you're about to sin, you just say, Holy Spirit, give me power to say no to it and walk away. You have the power to say no. So he's given you freedom from sin. He's also given you freedom from your destiny that sin has upon your life, which is an eternity in hell. And that sin has been destroyed in the name of Jesus, so you're not going to hell. You get to go to heaven. He purchased your freedom. 2:5 says that he raised you from death to life. 2:6 says he seated you in Christ at the right hand of the Father. And because he's done all these things, God can point to you in all future generations as examples of his grace. I was thinking about that this week, and I saw this. This is in Adriana's room. Y'all know this is a trophy, right? Who was wondering why that was up here? Who was thinking about it? No. No. This was my little girl. She's 12, and when I say little, she's little. She's little. And she played soccer for her school, and she got this. This is the Heart and Hustle Award. She's cute, right? She runs around. She's in a daze most of the time. I'm just being honest with you. My little girl, Adriana, is just off in La La Land most of the time. So I've gone to her soccer games, and I've seen this little girl that's awarded for heart and hustle sometimes just standing there, just kind of, they're playing, and she's just like, it's just funny. But everybody gets a trophy. You know, it's kind of cool. But trophies, you know, they commemorate great occasions, great feats, great accomplishments, championships, victories, big things, and you get a trophy that symbolizes something that was incredible. And when I read this, I'm thinking about that. I'm like, because of all that he's done, I think about this trophy, me. I'm a trophy of God's grace. I'm a trophy of God's grace. You know, I wonder, do you feel like you're a trophy of God's grace? You know, I know that all salvation is equal. Like, it's your salvation is just as amazing as mine, and yours is just as amazing as mine, and all of us, I mean, it's just incredible. Every single one of us says was dead because of sin and brought to life. Like, that's incredible. But I don't know about you, but it seems like the darker the cave, the deeper the hole that he pulled you out of, the more impressive it kind of, you know, the one who grew up in Sunday school and had never, ever said a real cuss word, you know, dang flip it is like the worst thing they've ever said. I'm not ripping that person in any way, but the one who was shooting heroin in their eyeballs, you know, and selling their body on the corner, and then all of a sudden totally transformed, like, that blows me away. It just, I know it's no greater than the Sunday school kid who never knew a day without loving Jesus. I know it's all the same, but it just, to me, it just seems greater. And I look at my own life, and I don't know if you do, you look at your life, and you start thinking about it, like, are you a trophy of God's grace? Yeah, I mean, could God point at you as an example to all future generations and go, look at what I did? And you think about that about yourself. I think about that all the time, and it quite often brings me to my knees. That's one of the things that kind of freaks me out. When I think about this perfect Jesus who did keep the law perfectly, who didn't deserve to die, didn't deserve any pain, willingly going to the cross to pay for my sin, and I start thinking of some of those sins that I committed. I mean, you all know, right? We don't glorify in our sin. It's bad. It's terrible. We shouldn't have done it, but we did. We don't bring it up like, hey, look at what I used to do. No. But now, when you've been saved, what used to be appetizing to you, just suck in sin and drink it like it was crazy, and you liked it. Now it makes you sick, and if anything, you think about it and go, man, I can't believe I did that, but God. Man, that's amazing to me. I hope that you'll do that. So, let me ask you this question. Why does God do this? Why does God do this? Because you're awesome? I've been going to church now for 12, 13 years, something like that. So some of you have been going a lot longer than me. But I know that when I first started going to church, one of the teachings that was just infiltrated the church like crazy. It was just this big expression. I think it might have been a Rick Warren thing. I don't know, but it was, it's not about you. Anyone hear this? It's not about you. It's not about you. It was this desire to move away from this God complex that people have, and the church shouldn't be about you and your desire. It's about God, right? I get it. But when I'm reading this, I started having these thoughts, and I just want to share them with you, and I think that there's biblical truth behind it, and I want to share this with you. So the question was, did God do this? Did he reach into the grave and save you because you're awesome? And some of you said no. Well, I'm going to just say yes and no. Now, I know that sounds crazy, right? Yes and no. I hate that when you ask a child a question, they say, yeah, it's the same but different. I hate that, right? And I'm kind of doing that right now. Yes and no. And it's not that I don't want to take a position. It's not like I'm being a coward. I'm not a coward. I'm just saying that there's a yes and that there's a no. So did he do it because I was awesome? Now, is it because awesome as in look at how good I am and how much money I give to charity and how good looking I am and I'm funny and I'm talented and I do this and I do that and I keep all the rules and heaven's going to be good, but with me it's going to be great? Is that why God did this? Because somehow glory is insufficient without me and he needs me there? No, not at all. As a matter of fact, the Bible will tell us in Isaiah 64:6 that when we display our righteous deeds, when we do our good things, that somehow will get us into glory. The Bible says that God looks at those righteous deeds as filthy rags. They're nothing. They're nothing. So it's not about what I say or what I do or what I can do. So it's not that I'm awesome in that sense, but innate value, yes. It is because you're awesome. Listen, you are awesome. You are amazing. Do you understand? You are amazing. I say that, hold the thought about you being amazing. Just marinate in that for a little while. I titled the message, God's Inheritance. And God's Inheritance, I grabbed this from three verses in the first chapter of Ephesians. I'm trying to support the fact that you are awesome. Ephesians 1:11, 1:14, and 1:18 all talk about an inheritance. Now in the first two, it says about this inheritance that God has prepared for you. You know, I'm gone away, I'm preparing a place, I'm going to come back, I'm going to get you, and you're going to have it. It's going to be amazing. And the second verse says the same kind of a thing, that God has an inheritance for you that he's prepared. Now, the first one talks about this Holy Spirit as kind of like the down payment, the first payment of the full salvation that you'll have when you're in glory with him, when he comes back to get you. But there's an inheritance that God has prepared that's incredible for you. But in verse 18, It's different. It says, I pray that your hearts will be flooded with light so that you can understand the confident hope he has given to those he called. Then he explains who he called. He's talking about you. He says, his holy people who are his rich and glorious inheritance. Now I start thinking about that, man. In light of this, it's not about you teaching in the church. And I'm like, wait a minute. So we're his rich and glorious inheritance. What is an inheritance? Like an inheritance, right? Listen, I have no wealthy family at all. None. I have no wealthy family. I'm not getting nothing. I have no rich grandma, no rich uncle, no long-lost guy that some oil sheik that's got $100 billion and he's going to write me a letter. Like, I got no chance of ever getting an inheritance from anybody. I got no cash in my family. But an inheritance would be cool, right? It would be awesome. Someday, there's going to be this envelope that comes from an attorney. He's going to say, man, your grandmother, she was socking it away in a mattress for 100 years, and there's $100,000 waiting for you. And, right? That would be amazing. I'm not getting that. Some of us will. Some of us will get more. This someday, you're going to inherit this amazing thing, and you have to look forward to it. And somehow, we are that for God. And it kind of blows my mind. This whole idea of innate value comes from Genesis 1:26. This is the Latin term imago Dei. It's when God says, let us make man. Let us make people in our image to be like us. That's That's incredible. Like, of all the things in all of creation, and that would blow your brain just to be thinking about that, all that you see and all that you know out there, right? Of all the things that you can see, cast your eyes and ears and taste and all that upon, there's only one thing in all of creation that is made in the image of God, and that is you. And so you have value. Now, this truth blew King David, it blew his brain. And if you look over in Psalm 8, go there with me, please. Go to Psalm 8, just three verses. Psalm 8, 3 through 6. This truth blew David's mind. And this is a book of encouragement, right? And so God wants you to be encouraged tonight. David said, "When I look at the night sky and see the work of your fingers," anyone ever done that? You ever go outside and just, wow, right? On those clear nights when it's just insane. The blanket of stars, he knows them all by name. They're not hitting each other. How can this happen? In Christ, all things are held together. You can come up with your own scientific theory if you want to, but I'm just going to go with what the Bible says. He holds all things together. That's why nothing's crashing into the earth. It should. There's trillions and trillions of things that are way bigger than the earth floating around us at 100,000 miles a second, and they don't hit us. All things are held together by Christ. And so David says, "When I look at the night sky and I see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you set in place," like we can all go there, right? He says, "What are mere mortals that you should think about them?" Human beings, he's talking about himself, that you should care for them. Yet you made them only a little lower than Elohim, which is God himself, and crowned them with glory and honor. You gave them charge over everything you made. Do you see your value beginning to display itself, people? This is you. You gave them charge over everything you made, putting all things under their authority, their flocks and their herds and all the wild animals and the birds in the sky and the fish in the sea and everything that swims the ocean currents. It's crazy. And Jesus Christ himself speaks of the Father's opinion of you in Matthew 6:26 when he says that the birds don't go around gathering food and storing it in barns, but that God takes care of their needs. Bless you. But how much more valuable are you than they are? I mean, it comes right out of the mouth of Jesus Christ himself. How valuable you are. You are awesome. You are awesome. And not awesome for what you do or what you say, but awesome for who you are, for who you are. Let me ask you real quick, just yell it out real quick. In all of creation, what do you think is the most beautiful thing you could see? Now, what's the most beautiful thing you see? Creation. What is it? Your children? Ocean. Yeah, that's a good answer. Yes, you had to say that now, right? What else? What's amazingly beautiful in all creation? Anyone?
Women.
Woman, you're married. Stars. Anything? What's the most beautiful thing you see? Flowers, sunsets, all those things, right? Incredible beauty. Mountains. I'm there. My favorite thing, when you can go, you can get, like, Google it stuff, autumn in Vermont. Like, the trees are on fire, and there's a little white steeple coming right up, right? And my soul just longs to go back to New England. Every October, I just get weak, and then my sister starts sending me pictures of the ice cream stand that I want to go. I hate her for that. I want to go, right? But those are the most beautiful things to me. But to think, listen, of all those things you just mentioned, that in all of creation, with all its beauty, what God cherishes the most is you. with all of your fears and all of your flaws and failures and all your problems and your pride and the way we hurt each other and insult and the filth that comes out of our mouth and the neglect and the mean and we hurt each other and all these different things that we all do, right? Everybody, it's you that he wants. That blows me away. You're awesome. Now, God being our inheritance, yes, I get it, right? When we die, we get this you know, glory, and there's no more tear and no more pain and no more sorrow and no more death, and all things are new and the streets of gold. Like, that's incredible, right? No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind can imagine what God has planned for those he loves. Like, God in the scriptures, everyone who describes heaven, they always use the word like. Because they don't even have a clue what it's going to be like. They saw this and it was like this. And they saw this and it looked like glass. And it's like gold. Like, no one understands. No mind can fathom what God has planned as part of your inheritance. And it gets better, though. That's not the best part of the inheritance. Revelation 21, 3 and 4 says the best part of the inheritance is that no longer will we be like this now when we close our eyes and lift our hands and pray to this God in heaven. No, we will be there with him and he will be there with us. He will be with his people. Like, that's the best part of your inheritance. So our inheritance is insane. It's incredible. It's marvelous. It's beautiful. All of God and all of his gifts, all for you. And God's inheritance is me. God's inheritance is you. Now, I don't know about you, but when I was writing that down in my notes, I was like, our inheritance, woo! And his inheritance. Yeah, right? Me. I leave my clothes on the floor. I stink. I fart. Pick my nose. Yell at people. I'm greedy. Selfish. Self-centered. Come on, right? I'm not the only one. Everybody, right? And I'm thinking, I'm his inheritance. Eh. Anyone with me on that? Eh. Compared to the streets of gold? Come on now. But here's the thing. I would want the Holy Spirit to work in you through this teaching what he did through me. And that is, I have to get my mind changed. The scriptures say that God changes us by changing the way we think. And so when I wrote that down, I was like, my inheritance, awesome. I wrote that, awesome. His inheritance, me. I started thinking, awesome. Eh. But you know how it really is? The truth. We got to live by truth. Who wants truth? The truth is, our inheritance is what? Awesome. And what's his inheritance? Awesome. That's the way God thinks of you and me, and so that's what it is. That's the truth. And we have to live on truth. When you begin to grasp this idea that you are God's rich, not just an inheritance, the scripture says, rich and glorious. I've never been, no, my wife is sweet. She called me sweetheart today in a text. But she did not ever write, my sweet and glorious husband. Like, she doesn't write, my rich and glorious husband, how art thou? You know, that's not happening. But God, his love letter, he's so much sweeter than my wife. I say that honestly. He is. He's incredible. She didn't save me. He said in his text, which is right here, that you are his rich and glorious inheritance. That's what he thinks about you. And when we start to grasp this idea, it explains what it says about Jesus in Hebrews 12:2, where it says, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising its shame. He didn't love the cross. Do you guys know that he didn't love the cross? Like, that was not something that he enjoyed. It was not something that he wanted. It's just something that he chose. There was a joy set before him. It wasn't happening on the cross. As a matter of fact, it says he was despising its shame. He didn't like being up there, but there was something. There was some joy that Jesus looked forward to so much that it seemed to actually eclipse the torment of temporary separation from his Father. You see, since the beginning of time, like way before time, was Father, Son, Holy Spirit, this perfect union. I and the Father are one, Jesus said. There was this perfect union all the time, always has been, always will. But there was a moment on the cross that not only did Jesus take upon himself the punishment for our sin. Let's take it to the truth level. He didn't take on the punishment of your sin. He became sin. He became sin. And the Father can't look upon sin. It makes him sick. And so he had to look away from his beloved Son because of you and me. And so what was this joy that was before him, someday coming, that would somehow eclipse this torture of being separated from the Father? What was this joy that made whipping him and stripping him naked in front of all people, people spitting on him, stretching him, nailing him, and him dying? What made that all worthwhile? You. You. You are his rich and glorious inheritance. We're mutual beneficiaries. God's making out pretty well because he's getting what he wants. And you and I are making out really well. We're not getting what we want. We didn't want this, but we get it. So if God is eternal and he didn't need to go to the cross, like he was God before anything happened, right? He was God. And if he never spoke the planets into existence, he'd still be God right now. And he'd still be God tomorrow and the next day and all that, even though there were no days, so I don't even know how you'd measure that, but he'd be God. So if he's God and he doesn't need to do this, because think about how little our little earth is with one species of humans and all these other stars and planets and galaxies and all this kind of stuff, this universe that's so massive, which, by the way, the known universe, the Bible says, are but the fringes of his robe. This is nothing compared to what he's in charge of and what he's watching and seeing and holding together and all that, right? Why, if he doesn't need to do this, then why did he? Do you wonder? See, I wondered as I was reading. Like, why would you do this? So I got two things for you. You can jot these two things down. The first one is that he wanted to. Pretty simple answer, but it's what the Bible teaches, and so it's profound and beautiful. Ephesians 1, 4, and 5, look what it says. Even before he made the world, you see? Remember I said God was God way before, right? So even before he made the world, even before he spoke the planets into existence, even before there was a person, there was a plant, there was a tree, there was water, there was anything, before all that happened, God loved you and chose you in Christ to be holy and without fault in his eyes. God decided in advance to adopt us. I got to pause there for a second. I was praying with the band earlier. And I don't know if you've ever stopped to comprehend this. But if there's one thing that the group of us as a band wanted for you tonight, was this. To experience. You know, the Bible talks about that you should all know how much God loves you and to experience the love of Christ. So he wants us to know things and he wants us to feel them, right? He wants you to know that he's adopted you into his family, but he also wants you to feel it. And I want you to comprehend what it would be like for a child whose parents either die or give them up. and they're in an orphanage for a couple of years or more, and unloved, unwanted, no hope. Until one day, the director calls them into the office and says, "Son, sit down. I got good news." Right? You're not unloved anymore. Someone loves you. You're going home. You're going to be part of a family now. That's you. That's you. You've been adopted. You weren't a mistake. You were chosen. That's truth. Swim in that for a moment. God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure. The Bible teaches that it was God's good plan to crush his beloved son for you. See, it sounds bad until you realize the next part of the story when Jesus says, "Yeah, that was just for a moment. I'm good now." See, it seems mean. Why would you do that to your own kid? Because God knew something that you didn't. God knew that his son would rise from the grave and live forever and come back perfect with a heavenly body. It was God's good plan to do it. Why did he do these things? Because he wanted to. Here's the second thing. Not only did he want to, but he wanted something. God wanted something as a result of this action on your behalf. Look at 1:14. It says he gives us the Holy Spirit. The Spirit is God's guarantee that he will give us the inheritance he promised, and that he has purchased us to be his own people. So there's this great truth that he's done this for you. And why did he do it? He did this so we would praise and glorify him. That's why. It's not so that you could just say, "Hey, I'm saved." It's so that you could spend your life praising him and bringing glory to him. The Bible says in Colossians 3:17, "Whatever you do or say, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." 1 Corinthians 10:31, "Whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God." Every single thing that you do, do it all for the glory of God. So I ask you this, in light of your of God's unmerited mercy on your life, in light of your undeserved salvation, have you made the choice, saints, that this is what your life is going to be about? To praise and glorify God. Is that the choice you've made? And is it not only the choice you've made, but remember what I said last week, let your teaching and your actions be the same. Be on guard. Have you made the choice that my life will be about bringing praise and glory to God, and not just in word or belief, but in action? Have you made that choice? Have you made that choice? I'd like to do something as the band comes up to close us out for the night. I'd like to read something to you. And before I read this, I'd like to ask you this. No, let me read this to you. Psalm 34:1-3. "I will praise the Lord at all times. I will constantly speak his praises. I will boast only in the Lord. Let all who are helpless take heart. Come, let us tell of the Lord's greatness. Let us exalt his name together." While they're playing, I'd like to invite you to do that. I'd like to maximum of 5 people. If you have something you'd like to praise God about, keep it at 10, 15 seconds at most, okay? We have a microphone right here. And you can come up and you can simply, if you want to, just let people know why you praise God. Is there, it may just be a Bible verse that is an anchor for your soul. It may be a section of scripture that you read it years ago and it changed your life. It may be a person, like I could stand up and I could just say, I praise you, Lord, for Ralph Howe, who never stopped inviting me to a Bible study when I was a sinner. Like, I could praise him for that because it led me to salvation. If there's anything that you'd like to share, or from your seat, just stand up and just tell us why you praise God. Anything. Loudly. Bible verse that I've read many, many times. I've shared it with you, but I think that I need to just once again praise him for it, because it, of all truth, it shapes who I am. It's the defining, I don't even know how to say it, but it defines who I am. It changed my whole perspective on everything. And it's in Colossians, and it just says, everything was created by him and for him. Everything. The reason I am a pastor is for him. The reason why I'm a dad is for him. The reason why I'm a husband is for him. The reason why I'm your friend is for him. The reason I get up and do anything, it's for him. And I commend that truth to you tonight. You are awesome. He does love you. He did save you. But everything that you are is for him. Amen.
I'm thankful for something too. For you guys. The privilege to worship the King of Kings. Amen.